Welcome to the Multifamily Zone, where business meets family. We explore what the entrepreneur life looks like from the family perspective. Now, here are your hosts, Julia and Gino Barbaro.
Hey, everyone. This is Julia Barbaro, host of the Multifamily Zone podcast. I'm here with the co-founder of Jake and Gino, my husband and co-host, Gino Barbaro. Hey, Gino.
Hi, Julia. How you doing?
Good.
What are we talking about today?
So I wanted, you know, I'm getting a lot of emails and just questions on basic stay-at-home mom, cooking, homeschooling the kids. And so I wanted to do a podcast on just getting back to the basics.
I've had a lot of requests out there because right now a lot of the kids are going to be staying home. Schools are going to be canceled. And people are coming up with their frustrations. They don't know if they can homeschool. How do they homeschool? What do they need to do? And we've been doing homeschooling for our whole 10 years since we've been married, right? Yeah. We got married 21 years ago. Our daughter, who's now 20, was homeschooled. Now she's a junior in college. We've had a lot of trials, a lot of tribulations. And I'm the first one to tell you, it is not an easy thing to do. It's really hard. But I want everyone out there to think of anything that they've done in life that is really worth it. Has it really been easy or has it been a challenge? And I said on another video, I think it's probably one of the top five things that I will always cherish. One of the top five things in my life that I did, and it was so impactful for me. The first one is obviously marrying my wife. Second one is having children. You know, top five. Third and fourth is deciding to homeschool. And for us in the beginning, it was hard because I came from a traditional background. You send your kids to school. We even had home births. You don't have babies born at home. You have babies in the hospital. But my wife is going to dive into this. And I think we all really need to, you know, be on board with our spouses and be supportive of it, of them.
Yeah. And that's the, definitely one thing that I wanted to talk about a little bit was we have to be supportive of each other because the kids hear it. And now that everyone's home, you know, it's right there in front of you. You know, it's hard to have that conversation with your spouse when the kids are always home, but you have to. It's important to be supportive of each other. And, you know, with, for us with schooling, one of the worst things is if my husband comes in and says, well, that's how you're doing it. And right in front of everyone. And it's really, really not a good idea.
So I've never done that before. Are you kidding me?
Just encourage you all to just, you know, give a minute. Let the other person figure it out a little bit on their own. If they want help, they'll ask. But be supportive of each other. And if you have a conversation, let it be amongst just the two of you. But that's really the key to success, in my opinion, is just raising a family is the support of the spouses, how they talk to each other, how they interact, how they communicate. And that's really what we have to work on first. But like Gino said, homeschooling is a challenge because I remember early on compared to now, the early on, you know, you're here, you are teaching the kids at home. And when we started, it wasn't so popular. So when we told someone we're doing it, it was very awkward. And so that was a challenge on its own. But when I started doing it, all my kids were little and I did not know what the outcome was going to be. And that's really the hard part because you're afraid that the kids aren't going to learn as much as the school kids and so on. And so that to me was a huge challenge.
And as you can see, my phone is ringing right now. And maybe it's one of my kids calling because we're doing a podcast. And that was the other thing. Let the phone ring. The other thing was it was challenging because they're home with you all the time. And like they're always on our mind and we're doing podcasts in between and figuring it out. And it really consumes your day. And if you don't have at least one argument throughout the day, you're just not doing it right.
That's
at least
right.
I think. Because it really is a lot of bantering back and forth. Mm-hmm. It's a lot. You're always together.
A lot of trial and error too.
You're always together and you hear everything, like nothing drops. And obviously as kids get older, they're going to go to different functions. So they're not going to be home all day because now our structure is kids have gymnastics on Monday. They have tennis on Tuesday. Some of them have choir on Wednesday, tennis on Thursday. And then there's drama. And there's different events you can go to. You can even do a co-op if you'd like. We're going to give you some, I guess, reasons to homeschool and some, I guess, next steps if you'd like to start homeschooling your children.
But even if you don't decide to homeschool, because that's also something to think about. And I just want to put that out there because it's super, super difficult because you're home all day, you're cooking. You know, I had a friend that contacted me and the funny part was the homeschooling, she got under control, but it was the cooking three meals a day was her challenge because that is a lot. It's a lot to cook. You have to clean up. And then you have to get to school and then you have to work with your husband, you know, just saying.
That's the most rewarding part, isn't it?
So it is difficult, but you know what? It's so rewarding. And I have to tell you, so even if you do decide not to homeschooling, just being present with your kids, learning about the kids differently than you had before is for me something that we could do now. You know, we have the time. A lot of people say, I don't have time to have a meal with my kids. We're all running around. We're doing baseball and all this stuff. And guess what? Now we have that time. We're home. We could cook. We could eat together. We can clean together. We can learn these things together. All these life skills that really schools don't teach. We got them at home. I could teach my kids to cook, how to clean up as you go. We could try new recipes. We could, you know, teach them how to clean. Because by the way, that is not something that we just naturally know how to do. We have to be taught that. Organization, all this stuff that we need to know at home for our success in life is going to be taught at home. So it's the time.
So I went to check the phone. That was one of the kids calling. So they're always around. But the amazing thing is, who do I want them calling? I want them calling me. And that is the number one reason for homeschooling, at least in my perspective, from my opinion. I have an amazing relationship with every one of my kids, and it's all different relationships. And some of their interests are some of my interests. So we talk about business, we talk about money, we talk about tennis, we talk about sports, we talk about faith. We talk about so many things that are interrelated that become part of the family, and you get such a great relationship with them. And it's a different kind of relationship than if I send them off to school and I don't see them all day. Mm-hmm. And then they come home, I'm busy from work, I'm stressed out, but now we're able to spend breakfast together. I can have lunch and dinner with the family. So for me, it's awesome. And what they're learning, sometimes I look at the stuff they're learning, I don't even know it. And it's challenging, and that's okay. We can either get a tutor, you can work with them, and Google will be your best friend.
Yeah. And that's, you know, right now what we have, the internet is amazing. There are, you could find every answer that you ever, any question you have, you find online. And that's something that we never had, especially when we first started homeschooling, when we first had children. And so it's a different challenge now. And I feel like now it's more how to keep the kids off the internet is really the challenge that, you know, that we didn't have early on. But it is true. There are so many ways to teach children nowadays and ourselves. And we all know that because we're listening to a podcast, right? We have online courses. There's so many ways. There's so many things that we could do right now to teach our children. And this is the opportunity to find out what their interests are. Because a lot of times we send them to school and half the time we don't even know what they're interested in because it's not even brought up. What are your kids interested in? Let's find out. Let that be something that we could really think about this week and ask them and do some research online. Say, hey, what have you been really wanting to learn or look into that we could do now? Let that be something that you do.
So I think the first reason we talked about is, and Julia's been talking about it right now, is controlling the education. Like, what are they learning? What do you want them to learn? There's certain things that they're learning in school that we don't agree with, and we don't want to teach them that. So we're teaching them our values. I want my children to look at me as the role model. I don't want them looking at LeBron or Derek Jeter as a role model. They can admire them and want to maybe emulate them, but I want to be ultimately their role model. And I want my daughters to have my wife as their role model. I think the next one is to control their friends. That's an important thing, your peer group. And I always say in the Jake and Gino community, your environment is so crucial, so important. So if your kids are hanging out with less desirable kids or kids who are always getting in trouble or kids who are doing drugs, you can't control that when they're going to school. I mean, you can, but it's a lot more difficult when they're homeschooled and they're little, or you can control who you hang around with and who becomes part of their peer group. And as they get older, they'll have, I think, the confidence and they'll have the intelligence to say, this person is great, this person is not. So being able to control who their friends and who they hang around with is, I think, really important when they're younger.
Yeah. You know, it's funny because I've actually had an argument with someone many, many years ago. I had that argument with a woman, And it made me stop and think about it. And I said, oh my gosh, am I looking at this the wrong way? And I had our son at the time was probably around 10. And I thought, okay, I said, maybe they're right. I said to Michael, I said, just go play with these kids. You know, they live close by, whatever. And he kept telling me he didn't want to. I'm like, all right, just go. And I found out that it wasn't a good situation. And he knew from just our values, like Gino talked about, they didn't line up at all. And here I was pressuring my 10-year-old to hang out with these people. And he knew better. And I was so proud of him. And I never pressured him again, because I'm like, oh my gosh, my 10-year-old just proved me wrong. And I was so thankful for that, because, you know, we as adults choose to who we hang out with. And I think that's important for us to remember, is that our children have a good sense of people. And we should probably ask them their opinion on it a little bit, don't you think?
He does look at me. He does look like me. He does take after me. So
yeah, but he's a mama's boy. So come on, you know that.
That's an awesome. I love that story. That's a great story.
No, but it's important to remember that we adults decide who we're friends with, who we're hanging out with. You know, the Jake and Gino community is huge about that, and like Gino just said, but our children should be too. Children should have high standard on who their friends are.
So
very important.
This next one, I think, is often overlooked, because we always get asked, what about the social aspect of it? No one ever asks about the education aspect of homeschooling. They think we live in a cave and we hang out by ourselves, and you know, we have goats and sheep around. We used to have chickens, right, in New York. But have your kids fall in love with learning? To me, public school and school in general, kids get up at 6 a.m. get on a bus at 7, they get home at 3. It's like a 9-to-5 job. It's like a full-time job. And then what do they go to school for? They go to school to do work. Then they come home and they do another 2 hours of schoolwork. What the heck is that? That's like you're doing a full-time job. And then some, make school fun. Make it enjoyable. Make it full of games. Play cash flow. Mm-hmm. Play Monopoly. Play all these different games that you're going to have fun with. You can learn at the same time. And don't, that's one thing I remember about school. It seemed like a job to me. And then when I went to do my job, I was like, wow, okay, I just was in school and I'm doing a job. So make the education fun. Don't make it seem as if it's work. And don't, you know, in homeschooling, we don't teach for the test. We just teach because we want them to learn. We want them to learn knowledge, and we want them to become critical thinkers. I think that's the difference between homeschooling and any other type of schooling, is we want our kids to fall in love with learning.
Well, for us, we do have a lot of homeschool families that we know. Many
amazing families,
and they're all different. And because some kids are very into test taking and some kids aren't, and that's the beauty of it, is that you as the parent get to decide what and how you want to teach your children. And I love that, because you know, we see how the kids learn, like we were talking about before, but also us as parents have strengths and weaknesses. You know, when our two of our oldest were in high school together, we actually reached out to a woman who was an educator. She was an English educator. And I said, can you come in once a week and do a writing class with my children? And we even invited some of the kids' friends over. So there was about 6 or 7 of them. Once a week, they would get together. They would do this great writing course, and they learned so much. But it was controlled. I got to control what they learned. I got to control where it was, who came over, the whole thing. And it was beautiful. And they learned so much. And I took advantage of that. And I would tell people, find someone that's an educator. She was a college educator. Come into your house and teach your children. If you have trouble with a certain subject that, you know, maybe you're not strong at, or you just want a break, because for me, to read the kids' writings is exhausting. You know, that to me is tiring. So I also had a little baby at the time. So I got someone to come in and to help me out. And that's, you know, the flexibility of it is amazing.
The last one that I'll put out there is teach your kids strength. Every child learns differently. Learn their modality of learning. Are they a visual learner? Are they an auditory learner? Or are they a kinesthetic learner? Do they like to sit down and be in a classroom setting and spend time? They're probably going to be good in school. Are they have a bundle of energy where they got to get up and they have to tinker and toy around, and they're good athletes? They're probably kinesthetic. They need to be doing stuff. Or can they listen to podcasts or audiobooks and learn that way? So really, you can tailor the education to their strength, instead of just teaching to the masses and saying, I hope my child falls in that bucket. So that's something that we learn. Each one of our children has a specific and unique gifts. Teach to their strengths and let them coincide with enjoying the education.
Yeah, no, that's important because even as they grow up, they change. So that's kind of the beauty of teaching them at home is you do know how, and you watch them learn, and it's so beautiful when they're learning to read and their eyes brighten up, and I love it. And then the siblings get on it and they teach the other kids. There are so many beautiful moments, but at the same time, when we're so nervous and think that we're not capable of it, we lack in confidence. That's when we're not at our best. And that's when the kids really suffer because they're not at their best. So I promise you, if we could just do our best, we're doing it, we're trying it. Just you being present as the parent in front of them sometimes is enough, is what they need. When we have little kids, when we have the babies and the toddlers, like I said, it's really a challenge. It really is. And we're sleep deprived, all that. But the kids are learning how to be a family, how to communicate with each other. Maybe mom's not present all the time because she's sleeping, because she's pregnant or whatever. It is what it is. And the kids will learn it and they'll remember it. And it's how you bring it up later on. Me and my daughter laugh so hard when we talk about that. When I was pregnant with my six and I literally slept the whole time. We talk about it and we laugh about it because, you know, it was hard at the time, but it was a good memory. And we bring it up quite often. We actually brought it up just trying to talk about this podcast. So it's, you know, the memories that you remember are important.
Let's take a quick time out to hear from our sponsors, and I'm going to go take a quick nap.
Gino and I are super excited to tell you about the audiobook version of The Honeybee, which was recently released.
The Honeybee tells the story of Noah, a disappointed, disaffected salesman who feels like his life is going nowhere until the day he has a chance encounter with a man named Tom Barnum, the beekeeper. In his charming, down-home way, Tom, the bee man, teaches Noah and his wife, Emma, how to grow their personal wealth using the lessons he learned from his beekeeping passion.
In the audio version, Gino and I sat down for an exclusive interview after each chapter where we elaborate on the stings we felt throughout the business, the importance of scaling up, and how we've been able to create multiple streams of revenue.
For more information and to get your copy of the audiobook, visit jakeandgino.com/honeybee.
Now we're back. I am energized from that power nap. I think the next step.
You don't know what it's like to be pregnant. I just want to tell you that.
As a side note, when my wife was pregnant, you're around your environment. I felt as if I was pregnant. And I know all the women out there are going to be like, I want to kill this guy. Yeah. He has no idea. But I mirror the symptoms. She's the leader, and she'd be tired on the couch, and I'd be like, oh. And it was tough. It was really difficult for us because a lot of energy in the house, having five kids, trying to teach them. I was at the restaurant. I was working a lot of hours, and it's challenging. And you're saying to yourself, well, you guys can do it, and I can't do it. I will promise you, if we can do it, anybody can do it, because it's all what your why is. Are you clear enough? Do you have clarity? We know what our why was. Our why was we wanted to have a family. We wanted to be responsible for our family. And we wanted to teach our family. And we wanted to have our family with us every day. So that was a strong enough why. And there's a lot of bumps in the road. Mm-hmm. A lot of challenges.
A lot of trials and error, definitely. Because I have to tell you, you should see the amount of books we have.
Start a library with the amount of books we have.
What books worked for one child did not work for the next. And that's something that you figure out. But if you're freaking out over it, like, oh my gosh, this one worked for my kid. Someone told me about this book. It's not working. It's okay. So change it. It doesn't matter. You know, and that's what I love about it is that we can customize the education per person. And why not, you know?
So I just want to leave everybody off with these three steps that you can take. The first one is you need a growth mindset. If you have a fixed mindset where you're saying, I can't do it, I can't try anything new, I'm not smart enough, that's the fixed mindset. The growth mindset is, oh, well, I'm presented with this problem. What can I do? I can try it. What's the worst thing that can happen? I lose a couple weeks of school. They go back to school. It's okay. But I've tried something different and I've learned from it. It's not cut out for me. Maybe it's not cut out for everybody.
Absolutely.
I ultimately believe anybody can do it. Mm-hmm. And it's just our setting our expectations and working together as spouses. But adopt that growth mindset. Really being able to have a challenge and looking at it and saying, I need to work hard at this because there's a lot of hard work involved, but I can do it, right? Yeah. I think the second one is responsibility, taking responsibility for your kids' education or just taking responsibility in life. We all have these setbacks now. We may be out of work for a little while. We may be having struggles. Let's take the responsibility and let's try it. And I think the third thing is let's make it fun. For the next few weeks and for the rest of this year or forever with homeschooling, mm-hmm. let's try to make it a little bit of fun. Let's try to inject a little bit of fun in it, and let's not make it seem as if it's only work. And I think children and adults, we both learn by making it fun and by playing games.
Yeah, and just be present. And I really just want to let you know, parents out there, that you being present to your children is what they need. You know, you being there, listening to them, talking with them, hearing their response and actually asking them a question and letting them answer, you know, is priceless. You know, do a family science project. Go outside, learn something outside. It doesn't have to be in a book. You can go outside and learn about, if you're near the beach, go to the ocean. If you're not, go out and find a tree and learn about a tree. There's so many things that we could do. And they could just be simple. And sometimes we just need to simplify our life and make it easier and not worry so much that we're going to mess the kids up. Because I've worried many, many years about it. And I realized it was pointless. And I realized that the kids are okay. The kids learned. They learn even how to teach themselves. That was one of my daughter's lines. When she went to college, she realized, she's like, why do we have to go to college and actually have the teacher in front of us when we're just reading the book and bringing the book home and doing it at home? So it was interesting that she knew how to teach herself. And that's what we're trying to do anyway as adults. So that's also one of the benefits of homeschooling. So just, I encourage you just to be present with the kids. Keep it fun, like Gino said. Enjoy each other. Learn about each other like you have not learned before. And support each other.
And annoying each other.
Yes, Gino. We were saying before, it's all great. There's so much to learn, but everyone is on top of each other and kids are around you all the time. And sometimes it's annoying. Sometimes you're just like, please stop talking. You know what I mean? So that's part of it. And that's just okay. It's all right. They will grow up. They will pay attention to how you react to it. Sometimes when it's just too much, sometimes it's just too much. Maybe if the kids are older, we just all take a break. Hey, you know what? Why don't you everyone go in the rooms and just read for a little while? Take a little break, but just lighten up a little bit. I just want to tell everyone, you are capable of this. You're able to do it. You know, we're all in this together. If you have any questions, please email me, juliabarbaro@gmail.com. Would love to talk to you. You know, that's
and you,
all.
You can email me at juliabarbaro@gmail.com.
Okay.
Since she's the homeschool mom. Listen, I love homeschooling. I love sitting down and reading with my children. I love doing a specific assignment or a specific, whether it's religion or mm-hmm. reading or math with one of the children. I love that. It's a great time to spend with the kids. But really, just sit down and for the next few weeks, just play it by ear mm-hmm. and see what happens.
Day by day. And yep. You know what? Talk with your spouse. Hey, today this worked, this didn't. Let's try it this way tomorrow. Mm-hmm. It's just an ongoing, you know, you figure it out yep. day by day.
I want to thank everyone for being part of the Jake and Gino family and sharing part of your day with us. Thanks, everybody.
Talk to you next week.
Take care.